Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Art of Being Indispensable at Work. Win Influence, Beat Overcommitment, and Get the Right Things Done by Bruce Tulgan. Narrated by Mike Chamberlain. Author's Note: I completed this book just weeks before the COVID-19 pandemic emerged and began killing so many, frightening all of us, and radically disrupting our world. Who could ever have imagined that such grave challenges might be just around the corner? This book was written to help you succeed in today's increasingly demanding and uncertain world of work. It is a guide to navigating through constantly shifting priorities and unclear lines of authority. It is about how to think and conduct yourself when there are so many factors outside your control. Well, the world just got a lot more scary and uncertain. I never anticipated this book being the How to Win Friends and Influence People for the Post-Pandemic Era. Nothing in it speaks directly to social distancing, personal protective equipment, hand washing, or even working from home or video conferencing. Moreover, no one can predict all the many ways this generation-defining crisis will reshape our society and the workplace. But one thing is clear. We have all just experienced, firsthand and together, how very much can change, so very quickly and with so very little warning. Now, so many of our workplaces have become virtual, organization charts are being redrawn almost by the hour, interpersonal contact has all but disappeared, and we are speaking to each other through screens. Even the most worthy, well-established missions and practices are being fundamentally challenged. So why is this book more important than ever? Let me explain. When everything around you spins out of control, what do you do? What can you do? You can control you. That's all you can do. When boom goes to bust, who is still indispensable? Who will keep adding value no matter what? Who will lead us through tough times? Who will pull more than their weight? Who will help us adapt and bounce back stronger than ever? Who will keep doing their best work very well, very fast, on time, and on budget? Who will do all this and, in the process, keep building up, rather than damaging, their working relationships? It will be the ones I call go-to people. They are the people I've been studying for decades now, whose ways of thinking and conducting themselves are the basis of all the advice in this book. They are the indispensables, those upon whom you want to model yourself in the best of times, and especially in these most challenging of times. But doing your job just got a lot more difficult and complicated. You and your colleagues, no matter where you're positioned on the organization chart, are relying on each other even more now than before. Many, after sheltering in place during the pandemic, will continue working remotely. Everybody will be under added stress for the foreseeable future, doing more with less, and tackling entirely new obstacles along the way. Every new request will feel like a special occasion or a 911 call. You don't want to let anybody down, especially in this new, anxious world. You will want to keep proving yourself to be that indispensable go-to person. In the post-pandemic era, the would-be go-to person is at greater risk than ever before of succumbing to overcommitment syndrome. Fight it. If you try to do everything for everybody, you'll end up doing nothing for anybody. Now more than ever, it will take extra savvy and skill to manage yourself, your many work relationships, and all the competing demands on your time and talent. The techniques in this book were not specifically designed for the post-pandemic era, but they might as well have been. If ever there was a time to adopt a true service mindset, this is it. The good news is that the more you serve others by seeking to add value in every interaction, the more they want to build you up and help you out too. People are more likely to work things out with you or take your word on something when you're known for being aligned with a chain of command and you have a track record of making the right decisions. When you can get things done very well, very fast for people, those people will keep coming back to you. Connection with people is the key. In the uncertainty of the post-pandemic world, people will be our anchors, our relationships to one another, a source of strength and security. Be a go-to person and build up your network of go-to people you know you can rely on. Invest in each other with intention. We can lift each other up and together be the jet fuel for the next great boom. Bruce Tulgan, May 2020. The art of being indispensable at work. 1. Fight overcommitment syndrome. Imagine that tomorrow morning, some high-priced workplace consultant shows up at your job. This purported expert on employee performance, some guy like me, is there to conduct a talent review, an assessment of all the personnel in the organization, including you. Who is indispensable at work? Who is notably dispensable? Who are the people in between? What makes it harder for employees to succeed in their jobs? What would this expert say about you? If you are like most people, that last question might make you pause. Not because you're not great at your job, but because these days, doing your job is a lot harder, requiring way more than it once did. You collaborate with lots more people than ever before. Not just those working alongside you, but all over the organization chart, up, down, sideways, and diagonal. It might be a one-time thing out of the blue, or maybe it is every so often. Some become regulars, many you know only by email. Others you see in meetings or hear their voice on a call. In addition to your direct boss and immediate teammates, you probably serve a seemingly unlimited number of internal customers at work. You are inundated by requests for help from colleagues, many of whom you might not even know. Other times, it's you who needs to rely on your colleagues, and the tables turn. Suddenly, you're the internal customer making a request of someone, often someone you cannot easily hold accountable. At some point, this state of affairs provokes you and your colleagues to utter, at least to yourself, one or both of the most common mantras heard in today's workplace. You are not my boss. That's not my job. But the truth is, you and most of your colleagues do want to be able to depend on each other and deliver for each other. Most everybody wants to be that indispensable go-to person. But nobody can do everything for everybody without succumbing to overcommitment syndrome, which makes it nearly impossible for anybody to consider you truly dependable, much less indispensable. It's the irony of ironies. The so-called go-to person becomes anything but that. Overcommitment gets in the way. The process of trying to become indispensable too often means stretching oneself beyond human capacity so that priorities become muddled. Important tasks are left undone or done ineffectively. All of this might leave you wondering when all this collaboration business is going to blow over so that you can get back to doing your real job. I have news for you. This is your real job now. Navigating collaborative relationships is not going away. And doing that job very, very well is how true go-to people in the real world win real influence, beat overcommitment, and get the right things done. That's the art of being, more or less, indispensable at work. This book will show you how. Welcome to the collaboration revolution. How did we get here? How did the ground beneath us shift from top-down management, with unambiguous orders coming from a clearly labeled boss, to collaborative work that slip-slides into our jobs from somewhere up there, down here, or way over there? To understand the answer, let's step back in time for a moment. When I founded Rainmaker Thinking in 1993, companies began inviting me to speak at their conferences, train their managers, observe their operations, interview their leaders, and conduct focus groups and interviews with their employees. That work has given me the opportunity to ask hundreds of thousands of people, we lost count at 500,000, in organizations of all shapes and sizes, some version of the same basic question: what challenges are you facing that make it harder for you to do your job and get things done? For more than a quarter century, the answers I've heard to that question have sounded remarkably similar. It seems that the same basic things that challenged people in 1993 are what they continue to grapple with now. From the beginning, for instance, I've heard from managers about the trouble they have managing their direct reports, and from their direct reports, about the many ways their managers could do better at managing them. Here, we're talking about work relationships in which the lines of authority are very clearly defined. But even in the 1990s and early 2000s, I also heard people talking about the challenges of work situations in which authority was not clearly defined. The interdependent relationships of collaboration, what we later started referring to as working across silos. Yesterday and today, getting what you need from lateral colleagues is difficult, especially if they are already overcommitted, since you have no easy way to hold them accountable. And juggling incoming requests from lateral colleagues is also difficult, for much the same reason. The difference between yesterday and today is that silos made the occasional collaborative work much easier and clearer. Everybody knew who they ultimately had to answer to. Most were able to simply keep their heads down and do their jobs within their own organizational reporting line, for the most part, their own team, department, or location. Today, that's all changed. While most employees are still organized in silos, at least on paper, their day-to-day working relationships are all over the organization chart. What I hear from people at all levels in all sorts of organizations and industries is that the biggest workplace challenge is collaborating with so many people in so many nebulous relationships. The speed and complexity of work requires so many more interactions with people up, down, sideways, and diagonal that what used to be fairly easy to manage has become very difficult for most mere mortals. Let's say you work in sales at a company that makes heavy machinery. Your job isn't just to convince prospective customers to buy a machine so you can make your sales numbers and please your boss. You are also managing a customer order specialist to make sure the order gets booked. And maybe you're dealing with warehouse staff to make sure there's a machine in the warehouse that's ready to ship. And you're talking to a shipping clerk to make sure the machine gets on the truck. Then you might want to double-check to make sure a service technician will be in place to meet the delivery truck and install the machine. That's when things go smoothly. When they don't, when there are no machines in the warehouse, for example, and after many weeks your customer is still waiting for the delivery, you start talking with manufacturing to see why inventory isn't keeping up with demand. Then you need to talk to someone in accounts payable to make sure your customer doesn't get billed until the machine has been installed successfully. Meanwhile, research and development wants to talk with you to get your customers' insights for future product improvements. Service wants to talk with you about your promising too much in the warranty package. Accounting needs you to get your expense reports in on time. And IT needs to make a change on your laptop. In today's workplace, even when things go well, the number of interactions required up, down, sideways, and diagonal for what once was a simple transaction, would make anyone's brain go on tilt. If you're that heavy machinery salesperson, you might well ask how you're supposed to find the time to do your job selling machines. That is what's on everybody's mind. Everybody at work is your customer now, and you are theirs. Up, down, sideways, and diagonal. That's because collaboration is the latest revolution sweeping across the workplace. It is called by many names, some newfangled: interdependency, lateral cooperation, self-managed project teams, cross-functional coordination, dotted line reporting, matrixed management. Of course, collaboration itself is not revolutionary. Collaboration is as old as human civilization. As long as people have been working together, it has always made sense for people on the same team to back each other up and help each other out. When people can draw on each other's expertise and experience, they tend to come up with smarter, faster, and better solutions together. That was true when ancient humans were hunting gazelles and wildebeest, and it's been true, for the most part, ever since. In today's context, the collaboration revolution is just a fancy way of describing the need for more and more people to work more and more closely together, more and more regularly, at all levels, in support of each other. So that, in a nutshell, is what's happened. You might be wondering why. Why is all this happening now? Some say all this new collaboration is nothing more than good old-fashioned teamwork at a much heightened scope, frequency, and intensity, brought about by technology, globalization, and decades of restructuring and re-engineering. That's largely true. But let's drill down. First, there's the macroeconomic situation. Today's world is more highly interconnected, knowledge-driven, and fiercely competitive. In ways that are unprecedented in history, even very small organizations are plugged into global networks of potential vendors, partners, and customers. Second, while it's true that employers continue to restructure and re-engineer for speed and flexibility as work becomes more complex, the result is more dramatic than simply heightened teamwork. Layers of management have been eliminated. Managers are now handed a wide expanse of control in which reporting relationships change with the wind. Meantime, most employees find themselves in short-term project teams on top of their regular jobs. In short, everybody's trying to do more and more while leveraging the same limited resources they've always had. My client and dear friend Jeffrey Krauss puts it this way: companies today need to be the best at many things in order to compete and win. Jeff is a go-to person extraordinaire and CEO of a leading laser company with operations worldwide. He told me recently that things are changing so quickly: customer needs, competitive threats, regulations, trade laws, that it's a full-time job just to orchestrate coordinated responses that jibe with the company's strategy. That's why, Jeff says, effective cross-functional collaboration is a must. Line managers can no longer manage up and down the line and expect the company to win. Instead, managers have to be accomplished tightrope walkers, managing the traditional line relationships while building alignment across multiple functions. Sales need to collaborate with product teams to get the right product to the customer, he says. Production needs to collaborate with quality, customer service, and finance to build the right stuff that addresses customer pain points. What does it all mean? What Jeff is describing is wholesale collaboration within the organization, as far down the chain of command as possible. The goal? To speed up and improve information exchange, decision-making, planning, resource sharing, and execution at every level of the organization, and to reduce unnecessary problems and waste. Such work environments, no longer hypothetical or futuristic, but alive and well, require everybody to deal directly with anybody and everybody every step of the way, even though they don't report to each other or, for the most part, to each other's boss. Think about corporate departments that provide shared services to every other department. Think of IT. Everybody in every department relies on IT to fix a computer problem, even though IT doesn't report up to those other departments. Or think of payroll. If you have a problem with your paycheck, you need to get payroll to work it out for you, even though none of the payroll people report to you or your boss. Or think of building maintenance. If the toilet is overflowing, who do you call? Or think about security, human resources, finance, legal, shipping, or receiving. We are all in shared services now. Whatever your role, wherever you work, in a restaurant, store, bank, accounting firm, hospital, school, construction site, or battlefield, your job is shared services, and so is just about everybody else's. More and more, to get your own job done, you and everyone else will be forced to manage directly many more working relationships than before, with a much wider range of colleagues in a much greater diversity of positions, many without clear lines of authority, up, down, sideways, and diagonal. There's a lot to love about the collaboration revolution. Working in shared services, putting our heads together to work through sticky problems, these things produce richer, more flexible products and services faster. So why is working this way driving everybody crazy? The trouble with collaboration. As much as business leaders want to laud all of the advantages of the collaboration revolution, people at all levels are frustrated by its many side effects. You are inundated by more and more requests. You are drowning, more or less, in a cascade of asks from internal customers. You want to be a good team player. You want the power that comes from being a go-to person, someone whom others are always trying to go to for help. And maybe you've got some ego invested in your ability to deliver for others. So, of course, you want to say yes. You know that you can't say yes to everyone and everything, but you often feel as if you can't say no either. You might wonder, if I don't say yes, then who will? The answer might be nobody, in which case you might feel as if you really have no choice but to say yes. Or the answer might be somebody else, in which case you feel you had better say yes or risk becoming less of a go-to person, at least to this customer. As a result, you probably often say yes when you probably should say no. Or you say yes without establishing realistic expectations and clear parameters about what you can do, when, and how. You say yes without asking the asker what you really need to know, such as when and how, so that you can actually deliver your part. Or maybe you are waiting for the other person to do their part so you can do your part. This leaves you wondering which work to do in what order. Your immediate boss might or might not help you prioritize. But it all has to get done as soon as possible. So, at any given moment, you probably owe too many things to too many people. Juggling so many commitments, you'll soon start dropping balls. It's just a matter of time. You feel as if you are always in danger of disappointing somebody. You certainly don't want to disappoint your boss or any of the other bosses. Your lateral colleagues, with less authority to hold you accountable, are the ones whom you are most likely to disappoint. Still, they need whatever they need from you ASAP. And when you disappoint your colleagues by not delivering for them, this leads to delays and missed steps in their work. Maybe they go over your head to complain to your boss, or their boss complains to your boss. You are likely to hear plenty about how you've disappointed your lateral colleagues. You might be thinking, "Oh, okay, boss, should I disappoint you next time instead?" Meanwhile, you're forced to rely more and more on people you cannot hold accountable. More frustrating still is when the shoe is on the other foot. Just like everybody else, you will eventually need to make requests of your colleagues, people who are working alongside you or in other teams, functions, and departments. But when you are forced to rely on them, it's easy to forget that your colleagues are facing the same pressures as you. They also want to be go-to people, so they probably say yes too often and, just like you, find themselves overcommitted, scrambling to manage competing priorities. And when your colleagues drop the ball and don't deliver for you, this leads to delays and missed steps in your work. So, maybe then you go over their heads. What else are you supposed to do? But think about it. What are they supposed to do? Like you, they cannot do everything for everybody. Everything is my job. E-I-M-J. In one organization I know of, when the challenges of interdependency resulted in a high level of frustration, with lots of people manifesting very negative attitudes, the CEO tried to repair the situation by mandating positive attitudes for all. He initiated a company-wide campaign around the slogan, "It is my job." Suddenly, there were signs and coffee mugs and pens and other paraphernalia emblazoned with IIMJ. Very quickly, the slogan became the office joke, and a more cynical version began to circulate. EIMJ. Everything is my job. In my work with companies, I see a lot of people who might as well be wearing a cape with EIMJ emblazoned on it. These are would-be go-to people in the extreme who epitomize what I call the superhero complex. Superhero at work wants to be positive and hard-working beyond the powers of mortal humans. The superhero wants to serve and impress everybody and disappoint nobody by doing everything to the double, triple, and quadruple extent. No assignment is too much. No load is too heavy. They figure they will defy gravity. Sadly, even the best attitude and most diligent work ethic aren't enough to keep overcommitment syndrome at bay. Nobody can work enough hours with a big enough smile to do everything for everybody all the time. Inundation plus no accountability plus EIMJ equals overcommitment syndrome. This syndrome emerges when everything on your to-do list is urgent and important, at least according to the people giving out the assignments and making the asks. New priorities are added to the list every day. Everybody is competing for limited resources, human resources first and foremost. There is competition for your time and their time. None of you will get everything done. At some point, you are bound to let each other down. Nonetheless, you keep saying yes to each other. As you all get more and more overcommitted, the chances of things going wrong for all of you start increasing. Delays become inevitable. Communications slip through the cracks. People misunderstand each other or lose track of specifications. As more things go wrong, everybody has more delays and mistakes to deal with, so everybody's overcommitment just keeps getting worse. Too often, you're waiting to proceed on a project because Ms. Delay hasn't given you a critical piece of the puzzle. And too often, you are Ms. Delay. Or you're waiting to complete a task because Mr. Mistake has to redo his part and get it back to you. And too often, you are Mr. Mistake. How on earth are you going to get what you need from each other when it feels like you're all at each other's mercy? You can badger. You can beg. You can bully, bribe, flatter, manipulate. You can convince, or at least con. Or you can go over each other's heads. Maybe your bosses can't work it out, and they go over each other's head to the boss's bosses. None of this does anything for your relationships, of course, and you will likely be told, it would be so much better if you could just work it out at your level. And maybe it would be, if those relationships were not already frayed beyond repair. Ultimately, siege mentality sets in. When you are drowning in other people's competing urgent and important priorities, and you have a hard time getting what you need from others, and it feels as if nobody is in control of these interdependent relationships, then pretty soon every interaction feels like a battle. You feel as if you are always under siege. Instead of embracing collaboration with your interdependent colleagues, you start to resist each other. You are still forced to rely on each other, but it feels like pulling teeth, ever chasing each other down to get what you need. You expect to be disappointed and thus become increasingly demanding. You take less time explaining and more time insisting, complaining, and blaming. Every incoming ask starts to feel like an attack to fend off. You become increasingly defensive. You work less to understand where others are coming from and work harder at hiding, debating, and resisting. Resentments grow. Pretty soon, no starts to seem like the only answer. More and more, you find yourself thinking, or actually saying, "That's not my job. You're not my boss." Siege mentality, at its essence, is a response to feeling out of control. That's the paradox. If you seek to gain control by embracing and projecting siege mentality, you lose control even more. You say no to everything, but not for the right reasons. You say no because of your workload and your mindset, not based on the opportunity or the person. The trouble is, the need to collaborate isn't going away just because you are hiding. You still need to rely on people you cannot hold accountable. You are still inundated with requests. If you try to hide, it starts to look as if you can't handle the workload, or you have a bad attitude, or both. When you resist, you cede whatever control you could possibly have and undermine your ability to gain more control. When you resist, people won't want to work with you, give you the best projects, accommodate you, give you the benefit of the doubt, expect the best from you, or even give you their best efforts. They'll work with you only when they have no other options. By resisting everything and everyone, you stop choosing opportunities and relationships. You miss out on great opportunities and create some bad feeling along the way. That doesn't mean you don't still have to deal with more work and more people. It just means there'll be less of your own choosing. The more you resist, the more collaboration becomes a weight with fewer choices, dragging you down. Siege mentality is like fighting with your rescuer when you were in over your head. Overwhelmed by overcommitment syndrome and overcome by siege mentality, some people burn out, blame the organization, and then leave. Wherever they end up, they probably will soon find themselves in a similar pickle. Others burn out, blame the organization, but nonetheless they stay and remain permanently stuck in siege mentality. If somehow they're able to keep their jobs, they become part of the bad attitude crowd, the not go-to people, people to avoid at all costs. Fortunately, most people bounce back from siege mentality sooner or later. Somehow they regain control of their time, or they get a good rest, and then they want to get back in the game. Whatever the case, they realize that always saying no, no, no is not a way to be a go-to person. So they start saying yes, yes, yes again. But it's hard to avoid getting drawn right back into the same no-win cycle. Yes, yes, yes leads right back to overcommitment syndrome, which leads right back to siege mentality, which leads right back to no, no, no. Get me out of this no-win cycle. For most people, all these extra working relationships with all these extra people, up, down, sideways, and diagonal, mean a whole lot of extra work. It seems as if everybody needs something from somebody all the time. What makes these relationships especially challenging is that the lines of authority are usually unclear. Often you or your collaborators don't report to each other, or even the same person, in the ordinary chain of command, which leaves lots of room for misunderstandings, mistakes, and missed opportunities. The situation is extremely complex, but the problem for you is simple. How do you and your interdependent colleagues get what you need from each other when no one has the authority to make it happen? You might think the answer is, if I don't have authority, I just have to use influence. The trouble with influence. Influence. It sounds so compelling on the surface, a source of power with heft and endurance. Conventional wisdom holds that when there's no clearly designated authority, using one's personal influence is the way to get things done, certainly to have them go your way. Influence actually may be even more potent than authority, not just a second-tier alternative as implied by the conventional wisdom. But there's real influence, and then there's false influence. Understanding the difference is critical to succeeding in today's workplace, in which lines of authority are so often unclear. Let's start by comparing authority and influence. Authority is official power, position power in an established hierarchy within an organization with rules and resources. Authority gives you the power to make decisions and enforce them through control over rewards and punishments. If you have authority, then people do things for you because they're required to comply. This makes authority a highly resource-intensive enterprise because it needs monitoring and policing. Influence, on the other hand, is less conventionally powerful than authority. It comes without position, rules, or control over rewards and punishments. Yet it is infused with unofficial power that can prove every bit as potent as the official variety, and even more so. Influence is the power that others invest in you because they want you to have it. It is a function of what other people think of you and how they feel about you. If you have real influence, then people do things for you because they want to. It costs nothing because there is no enforcement required. Plus, people tend to work smarter, faster, and with a much better attitude when doing things because they want to do them. But remember two things. First, regardless of how much influence you have, you can never ignore authority. Somebody is always in charge, even in organizations that are highly matrixed. Somewhere, someone is making decisions. There is a chain of command in which, wherever you are placed in it, you'd better be sure, step one, that you are aligned with your boss and the leadership. You need to know what's required. You must be clear about what decisions the higher-ups are making and what the priorities, ground rules, best practices, and current marching orders are. If you have direct reports, then, step two, make sure your direct reports are aligned with you and your boss and the leadership. Before you can deal effectively with your colleagues sideways and diagonally, you must first ground yourself vertically, up and down the chain of command. The second thing to remember is that trying to use influence is fundamentally flawed if you seek to leverage real influence as defined earlier. That is, the kind of influence, and therefore power, you have because others want you to have it. Think about it. If you try to use your influence to get your way with colleagues, you might, for example, try to bribe your colleagues or otherwise seek to establish a quid pro quo, threaten to withhold support for them in the future, badger, bully, and/or manipulate them, charm and flatter or otherwise seek to ingratiate yourself with them, point fingers, blame, complain, or otherwise undermine them, go over their heads. The problem with these tactics is they are all akin to influence peddling, putting one form or another of pressure on people to get them to comply. They are all poor stand-ins for authority, efforts to wield rewards and punishments without official position power. They might get you what you want in the very short term or even for a while. And, of course, there are always con men, thieves, and violent criminals who get away with using such pressure again and again. But none of these tactics will result in people wanting to do things for you. More likely, they'll make people root against you, wish for your failure, or work to take away your power, not give you more. That's why I call such tactics false influence. Unfortunately, many people employ them in hopes of getting what they need within the free-for-all of our new world of self-managed teams and interdependence. And yes, sometimes false influence can work, for a while. Real influence, on the other hand, fosters authentic, abiding power that enables you to succeed, regardless of how much organizational authority you might or might not have. The real influence of the go-to person. So how do you become a person with real influence, which grows and strengthens over time, rather than false influence, which, at best, is short-term? How do you make other people want you to be more powerful and want you to succeed? How do you make others want to contribute to your success, make valuable use of your time, and work in smart ways on your behalf? The answer, based on our decades of research among more than 500,000 people and more than 400 organizations with which we've worked, is simple. Serve others. Stop focusing on what other people can do for you, and focus instead on what you can do for other people. Make yourself super valuable to others. The more value you add, the more truly invested others will become in your success. That's how you become indispensable. That's how you build up the real influence that makes you a true go-to person. Here to serve. I've been studying go-to people for decades now. Whenever I work with organizations, I ask everyone, who are your go-to people? And I pay close attention to the individuals whom others cite most frequently and consistently. Go-to people come in every variety and work at every level, and are found in organizations of all shapes and sizes in every industry. There are as many different styles and stories as there are go-to people. But when I look for the common denominators, what unites them all is that they know how to make themselves valuable to others consistently in most every interaction, and they do so over time. So, you might think that go-to people must be the technical experts with very sharp skills for important tasks, responsibilities, and projects. And, of course, go-to people must certainly be very good at their jobs. But that's just table stakes for the go-to person, like hard work and a positive attitude. More to the point, not all technical experts are go-to people. I've seen a zillion cases where an employee is, by far, the most technically skilled.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.